Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ikeda.
Hello friends, now we are going to talk about the first member of the P block element, that is group 13 elements. And in this chapter, basically we are going to discuss about group 13 and group 14. So let us discuss about the group 13 elements, means what are the variations that we could find in group 13 elements. So now let us discuss about that. So this variations in the properties of the group 13 elements, we are going to focus on basically four properties, and that is atomic size, ionization enthalpy, that could be electronegativity, and that could be oxidation state. So these are the four properties that we are going to talk about, where it changes, or where we could find that there is a change or there is a variability in this kind of properties. And let us start with the first one, that is atomic size. So before talking about the atomic size, let me discuss about the group 13 elements, and those are. So those are basically, if we are talking about group 13 elements, and those are basically boron, aluminium, gallium, indium, and thallium. So these are the elements that we are going to talk about, and now let us discuss about the atomic size. So if we are talking about the atomic size, and as we know that is, if we move that is from top to bottom across a particular or along a group, then atomic number increases rapidly. For example, for boron it is 5, but for aluminium it would be 13. For gallium it would be 31. So therefore we could find that there is an increase in the atomic number. So if there is an increase in the atomic number, obviously the number of shell will also increase, and thereby we could say that if the number of shell increases, thereby the atomic size also increases. And for a regular manner, we could say that the boron will have a smaller size compared to that of the aluminium, and gallium will have also more size, and ultimately thallium will have the maximum ionic size or atomic size, if you talk about, especially about talking about the atomic size. So therefore that would be the main thing that we could say, that the atomic size goes on increasing. But still there we could find a certain kind of variation, and what are those variations? Let me talk about that. So boron being the first element of the group 13, so therefore we could say that because of which the atomic size is also very much less, and that's the reason that boron is basically it is very hard in nature. And since boron has the smaller size, so therefore we could say that aluminium should be the one which has a larger one, and then of the gallium it has the larger atomic size compared to that of aluminium. But it has been found that boron has an atomic size of basically 88 picometer. While talking about the aluminium, it has been found to be 143 picometer. So here we could see that the there is an increase in the atomic size in the regular manner that we have expected. But talking about the gallium, so gallium is the one which has an atomic size of 135 picometer. So here basically the atomic size has been reduced, so it was not expected. Actually the thing is, if we talk about the boron, so boron has basically an electronic configuration that we know as 1s2, 2s2 and 2p1. But talking about the aluminium, even it has 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2 and 3p1. But talking about gallium includes that is d orbitals also, and those d orbitals or those electrons that have been belonging to d orbital that have been present inside the valence shell. And as we know that d orbitals are not having that much of shielding effect, or they have poor shielding effect, so that's the reason the nucleus will have a more attraction towards the outermost electron, and that is nothing but the electron that is belonging to the valence p orbital, and that's the reason the attraction of the nucleus towards the outermost electron, it will be more, and thereby the atomic size decreases. So that's the reason we could find that is the atomic size goes on decreasing here. But in after that is after gallium, that is we have indium. So if you talk about indium, and ultimately that is thallium, so talking about the indium, then indium has an atomic size of that is 167 picometer. So and talking about the thallium, it is found to be 170 picometer. So hereby you could see that the atomic size in a regular pattern, it should be go on increasing, and that is what it is going on increasing. But in case of that is aluminium, it is increasing, but meanwhile at gallium it decreases because of the d electrons that have been present in it, and present inside the valence shell. So that is what there is a variation in atomic size that we have observed over here. So this was the first property that I was talking about, and now let us move on to the next one, and that is, so as we know that energy enthalpy is nothing but the energy required so as to remove the loosely bonded electron from an atom, and that is what the energy enthalpy is, and it is has a unit of, that is kilojoule per mole, that is we have to remove 1 mole of an electron from an atom. So now let us talk about the next property, that is energy enthalpy. So talking about ionization enthalpy, we know that it is the minimum amount of energy that has been required so as to remove the loosely bonded electron from an atom, and that is what we are going to talk about. But here also there is a kind of variation that we could see compared to that of the expected value. For example, as we know that if we move, that is down the group, that is from boron to thallium, then obviously the atomic size goes on increasing. And since the atomic size goes on increasing, then the electron that is being present in the valence shell, obviously it will have a lesser nuclear charge. That is what we expect. And that is how we could remove easily one electron from the outermost shell. And this is what we have expected. But still, there is a kind of variation that we could see in the ionization enthalpy. And what are the reason behind that is, let us talk about that. So before moving towards the ionization enthalpy, let us discuss about what are the values that we could get for the first ionization enthalpy for the elements that are belonging to group 13. So talking about the first one, that is, if we talk about boron, then the boron has basically ionization enthalpy, it has been found to be, that is 801 kilojoule per mole. Because ionization enthalpy, it is related to energy, so therefore the unit is in kilojoule per mole. And for talking about the aluminium, it has been found to be, that is 577 kilojoule per mole. So obviously, as expected, that if boron is the first element, obviously it will have a lesser size and it will have more nuclear charge, and that's the reason the energy required to remove the loosely bonded electron, obviously it will require more energy to remove the outermost electron for boron. And for aluminium, it will require less amount of energy as expected, because it will have a larger size compared to that of boron. But what if we are talking about gallium? So suppose if we are talking about gallium, then it has been found to be, that is 579 kilojoule per mole. So if you observe this thing, then we could get, there is no larger difference in the ionization enthalpy. In fact, the difference is very much marginal. And if you could observe, then the gallium has basically 579 kilojoule of energy, which is comparatively, if we compare it with aluminiums, so it will be 577. So obviously we could say that the gallium has increased in its ionization enthalpy. So this is all because of the size. So it's all because of the size, and we have got to know that the gallium has an atomic size of 135 picometer. That's the reason it is basically, it has a smaller size compared to that of an aluminium, and that's the reason that the electron that is present in the valence shell of the gallium, it is very much it is very much attracted towards the nucleus, and that's the reason to remove that electron, it is very much difficult. And that is what the ionization enthalpy, here we could find that it increases. And now let us talk about the next element, that is indium. So if you observe and if you compare it with the gallium's ionization enthalpy, then we could find that it has a lower ionization enthalpy. That means we have to give less energy so as to remove the outermost electron, because, and in a regular manner it goes on in that form only. That is, if we move from top to bottom, then we could get that is the ionization enthalpy, it decreases. So now let us understand about the last one, that is thallium. So for thallium, it has been found to be 589 kilojoules per mole. So if we compare it with indium, then we could get that is the ionization enthalpy increases for thallium. So the reason behind that is, obviously we have understood about the d orbitals that are being present below the valence shell, and that's the reason, because of its poor shielding effect, the nucleus will have more attraction towards the outermost electron, and that is how the energy required to remove that electron, it's very difficult. So in that case, basically here we have found the change in or variations in ionization enthalpy. So this was the second property that I was talking about, and now let us move on to the next one, that is electronegativity. So talking about electronegativity is nothing but the tendency of an atom or an element to attract the electron of the another element toward itself, or to attract the lone pair of or shared pair of electron towards itself. So we are talking about the electronegativity of group 13 elements, and for that let me discuss about the few data that it has been calculated. So for boron, actually the electronegativity has been calculated to be 2.0. And that of that is the aluminium, it is found to be that is 1.5. And so it goes on. So for example, in this two cases, of course, if I am talking about, so as we move from top to bottom along a particular group, then the atomic size goes on increasing, and that's the reason that we expect that the electronegativity, it also decreases. The reason that is the electronegativity depends upon the size, and the smaller the size of an atom, then there will be higher it will be the electronegativity, because obviously the nucleus will have an attraction towards the outermost electron. And since the we are talking about boron, suppose, so boron is the one which is having a smaller size, and that's the reason the nucleus will have more attraction towards its outermost shell or outermost electron that is present in the outermost shell, and thereby it has also the tendency to attract the other electron. And it also depends upon that is the electron deficiency, so as to complete a noble electronic configuration. So now let us move on with the further point, that is for aluminium it is found to be 1.5, but if we compare it with that of that is gallium, then it has been found to be 1.6. For indium it has been found to be 1.7, and ultimately for thallium it has been found to be 1.8. So here you could see that there is an increase in the electronegativity, and that is from this region to this region, and here only where we could find that there is a decrease, and that is a larger decrease in the electronegativity that we could find. And after that the value should goes on decreasing, but it goes on increasing. So such kind of variation in electronegativity is also been observed. So in this manner, suppose if I'm talking about this group 13 elements, then the one thing has been shown that since boron is the one which is having a higher electronegativity, so therefore it acts like a non-metal. And talking about the aluminium, gallium, so these are basically the one which are having a metallic character. And talking about the thallium, which has basically an electronegativity of 1.8, is actually the one which is present in the last and it is the last member, and it will have less electronegativity, or it will have, we could say, it will have more electro positivity. So this was related to the electronegativity, and this is where the variations. And now let us move on to the last one, that is let us talk about the oxidation state. So before talking about the oxidation state, there is a concept that I want to discuss about, and that is known as inert pair effect. So what is inert pair effect? Let me talk about that. So discussing about the inert pair effect, but then let us understand the definition of it. That is, in case of heavier elements, the s electrons that has been present in the valence shell remains paired and do not participate in chemical bonding. So this effect is called as inert pair effect. Yes, so let me discuss about this inert pair effect in a brief. So for example, if you talk about a smaller element, that is, suppose if you are talking about boron, so boron has electronic configuration that we know as 1s2, 2s2 and 2p1. So it is not a heavier metal, a heavier element. In fact, it is the one which is basically a lighter element, and it doesn't have the d orbitals also. So because of which, what happens is the electron that has been present in the outermost shell, it has a very much attraction towards the nucleus, but meanwhile it can also exhibit +3 oxidation state. The reason behind that is because it doesn't consist of d orbitals, and that's the reason that it has a capacity, or it has a tendency to lose 3 electrons so as to form bond, or so as to contribute a bond, and that's the reason we could found that is BCl3 is basically the one which is a stable compound. So now talking about the heavy elements, like suppose thallium, suppose if I'm talking about thallium, or like gallium and all, so that consists of d orbitals, or that consists of d electrons in it, and that's the reason that, as we have also got to know, that d orbitals are not that much, they don't provide that much shielding effect, as well as we could say that they have poor shielding effect. That's the reason the nucleus will have more attraction towards the outermost shell electron, and that is, in this case, it is basically, it has been found to be for an s orbital. So here also the same thing that I have mentioned over here. So because if they have more attraction towards the ns orbital, so therefore the s orbital, they won't participate in bonding, and thereby they act like they are acting like an inert pair. And that's the reason this kind of effect that are exhibited by the heavier metals or heavier elements are basically known as inert pair effect. And thereby, the only one orbital that has been remaining so as to contribute a bond, and that is basically p orbital or np orbital that consists of one electron. In especially, we are talking about that is group 13 element, and that's the reason. Now let us talk about the oxidation. Now here I could explain you that how, why, and how basically the oxidation state are been changing in the group 13 element. So from the previous one, we have got to know that is about the inert pair effect, that is the boron will exhibit clearly plus 3 oxidation state. And talking about the other elements like aluminium and gallium. So as we move from top to bottom, that is from boron to thallium, then the stability of the plus 3 oxidation state, it goes on decreasing. Thereby, we could say that thallium is the one which will exhibit plus 1 oxidation state only, and that is how it will form a stable oxidation state. And boron is the one that will form plus 3 stable oxidation state. But we are talking about the other elements that are between boron and thallium, that is aluminium, gallium and indium. So thereby they show they also exhibit plus 3 oxidation state. And for aluminium, we know that aluminium is the one which is very much stable in plus 3 oxidation state, and that's the reason AlCl3 is a stable compound. But talking about the other elements like gallium and indium, they somewhere they show plus 3 also and plus 1 also. So that is what I was talking about, that is the oxidation state. But now let me discuss about the other few points also, so that we could be clear with our doubt that how the oxidation state changes and why basically boron is the one which is exhibiting plus 3 oxidation state more in a stable form. So in this case, we are going to talk about that why boron is exhibiting a stable plus 3 oxidation state and thallium, it exhibits stable plus 1 oxidation state. So there is a reaction that I want to talk about, and this is also related to the that is oxidation and reduction. So let me discuss about that. Suppose if we have a reaction, and the reaction is basically so this is a reaction that where we could found that is the product that has been formed, it is basically so this is a product that we have after this reaction. But if you observe that in this case, that thallium has an electronic configuration of or it has an oxidation number of plus 3, because the chlorine is the one that has an oxidation state of minus 1. So that's the reason the thallium will have the oxidation state of plus 3. While talking about the iron, that is in case of FeCl2, so therefore it has been found to be that is 2 as an oxidation number, and in this case it is found to be 1, while in this case it is found to be that is 3. If we have observed, then this thallium, which has an oxidation number of 3, it readily it converts into an oxidation number of plus 1. This indicates that thallium is very much stable in its plus 1 oxidation state, and that's the reason this thallium, it undergoes reduction, that is by gaining electrons, and thereby it is acting like CL3, it acts like a best oxidizing agent. So therefore we could easily say that TLCl3 is acting like a good oxidizing agent, and thereby the reaction is moving in this manner. So thereby we could also say that when it comes to the compounds, like suppose if I am talking about BCl3, and if I am talking about that is TLCl3, then it has been found that BCl3 is basically more stable compared to that of TLCl3. So that is what I was talking about, and that's it. So this is was related to the oxidation as well as reduction that we have mentioned over here. So thank you friends for watching this video, and this were the different variations that we could observe in group 13 elements, and there are also further things, but these are the main points that I want to discuss about. So thank you friends for watching this video. I hope you will share this video with your friends, and yes, don't forget to subscribe to Ikeda channel. Thank you so much.